Today to everyone, so our topic is all about the fundamentals or the introduction to criminal law. So in the origins of law, order is essential for a society, and the law can be conceived as simply a body of rules governing a social order. So this topic provides a brief discussion on how laws came to be. So distinctions are made among the terms norms, folkways, mores, and laws. So norms, it indicates the societal expectations of what is right or normal or of what ought to be. So they may also indicate what is wrong or abnormal, what ought not to be. And folkways define what is socially approved or disapproved, but they do not reflect a sense of moral obligation. So their meaning is perhaps best captured by this phrase, thou should or should not do something. So the penalties that accompany their violation are relatively mild and include the ridicule or and ostracism. While mores, these are also informal norms, but adherence is far more obligatory. So thou must or must not do something. So violation of a more is met with a strong sense of moral obligation. But moreover, the penalties that accompany the violation of mores are far more severe, including in extreme cases like the death penalties. So while the laws, this is the formalization of folkways and mores. And when we say law, it has two forms. We have the customary laws and the enacted laws. When we say customary laws, these are perhaps the oldest form. They represent the codification of traditional practices and include the definitions of the condemned act or omission, the procedures for determining the guilt or innocence, and the punishment for those found guilty. So an example of this customary laws is the Roman law, more popularly known as the 12 tables, about 400 BC. So these laws governed all aspects of life and death in Rome, including crimes and punishment, okay, for nearly 2,000 years ago. So but in contrast, enacted laws are deliberately recorded by an official representative or representatives of the community. So they are explicit and carry the weight of the community, and the intent of enacted law is deterring crime through punishment rather than merely serving as retaliation or revenge. Okay. So what is criminal law? So first, what is law? When we say law, this may be defined as the formal social control involving the use of rules or norms that are enacted, interpreted, administered, and enforced by specialized agents of the political state or community. Specifically, laws are formalized rules that prescribe or limit actions. So when we say criminal law, is that branch or division of law which defines crimes, threats of their nature, and provide for their punishment. This is under the revised penal code. So another meaning of criminal law is a branch of jurisprudence that deals with offenses committed against the safety and the order of the state. So also criminal law is a public law as opposed to private law, because the state behaves as if it were the aggrieved party when criminal law is breached. And another one is when you say criminal law, it is a statutory law because it is derived from statutes enacted by duly by authorized legislative bodies. It is substantive because it is administered and enforced by court. So what are the goals of law? So people engaged in any criminal act are eligible for severe sanction. By outlawing these behaviors, the government expect to achieve the following goals in creating its country's penal code. So we have enforcing social control, discouraging revenge, expressing public opinion and morality, deterring criminal behavior, punishing wrongdoing, maintaining social order. So these are the goals of law. So when we say enforcing social control, those who hold political power rely on criminal law to formally prohibit behaviors believed to threaten societal well-being or to challenge their authority. While discouraging revenge, so by punishing people who violate the rights, property, and freedom of others, the law transferred the burden of revenge from the individual to the state para maiwasan na yung tinatawag na revenge. So expressing public opinion and morality, so criminal law reflects constantly changing public opinions and moral values. So it changes according to social conditions and attitude. Okay. So next is deterring criminal behavior. If there is a criminal law, okay, so criminal law has a social control function. So it can control or restrain and direct human behavior through its sanctioning power. Okay. So the threat of punishment associated with violating the law is designed to prevent crimes before they occur. And punishing wrongdoing, the deterrent power of the criminal law is tied to authority. It gives the state to sanction or punish offenders. So those who violate the criminal law, they are subject to physical coercion and punishment. And the last one is maintaining social order. So all legal systems are designed to support and maintain boundaries of the social system they serve. So in a way, the contents of the criminal law are a mere reflection of the needs of those who control the existing economic and political system than the representation of the law. So what are the characteristics of criminal law? So the characteristics of criminal law are the following: politicality, specificity, irregularity, uniformity, and penal sanction. So when we say politicality, this refers to the legitimate source of criminal law. Saan magaling yung batas na yan? So only violation of rules made by the state. So that is the political jurisdiction that enacted the laws are crimes. So violation of rules made by other institutions such as the families, churches and schools and the employers may be bad, sinful or socially unacceptable, but they are not crimes because they are not prohibited by the state. Okay. And specificity, so it is the scope of criminal law. So although civil law may be general in scope, criminal law should provide definition of specific acts. For example, in this specificity is a person stole an airplane but was found not guilty of violating a criminal law that prohibited by taking a self-propelled vehicle. So the judge ruled that at the time of law was enacted, vehicles did not include the airplane. Okay. So next is regularity. So it means the applicability of the criminal law to all person. So ang batas ay may apply sa lahat ng tao. So thus, ideally, when criminal law are created, they should apply not only to the men who violate them, but also to the women or vice versa. And uniformity, it is how the criminal law should be enforced. So ideally, the law should be administered without regard for the status of a person. So for example, whether the offender is young or old, rich or poor, and so on. So the criminal law should be enforced uniformly. And the penal sanction, violators will be punished or at least threatened with punishment by the state. Okay. There would be no point in enacting criminal laws if their violation were not responded to by punishment or threat of punishment. So next is the development of criminal law. The beginnings of criminal law can be traced more than 3,000 years ago. So the following are the ancient legal codes recorded in history. First is the Code of Hammurabi from 1750 to 1792 BC. So the Code of Hammurabi established a system of crime and punishment based on physical retaliation or an eye for an eye, tooth for a tooth method. So for example, is if a physician perform a careless operation, his hand will remove. So he were responsible for the death of a woman through a miscarriage, the life of his the life of one of his daughters was taken also. So the severity of punishment also depended on class standing. So if convicted of an unprovoked assault, the slave would be killed, whereas a free man might only lose a limb. So that is the Code of Hammurabi. So next one is the Mosaic Code, about 1200 BC of Israelites. So this was based on tradition that God entered into a covenant or a contract with the tribe of Israel. So in return for God's special care and protection, they agreed to obey his law or the 613 laws of the Old Testament, including the Ten Commandments presented to them by Moses. So another ancient legal code is the Roman law, about 450 BC. So this is contained in the 12 tables formulated by a special commission of 10 noble Roman men. In response to the pressure from lower classes who were referred to as plebeians. So the plebeians believed that an unwritten code gave arbitrary and unlimited power to the wealthy classes known as the patricians, so who serve as a magistrate. Okay. So the remnants of the code reflects laws on debt, family relations, property, and other daily matters. So another one is Draconian Code. So the Draconian Code of Greece, way back 17th century. The Draconian Constitution of Dracos Code was a written law code created by Draco near the end of 17th century. Okay. Before Christ, in response to the unjust interpretation and modification of oral law by Athenian aristocrat. Okay, and next is the Hindu Code of Manu. So in India, the date of publication is uncertain but believed to be about 200 BC. Okay, it was a hybrid of moral religious law code and one of the first written law codes of Asia. So in spite of its age, it has sustained paramountcy in the Hindu culture, and it was also the code of conduct for intercaste relationship in India. So this ancient Hindu law code of India collectively called as Smirtu. And the next one is the Quran, or in the Islamic society. So the Quran, or the anglicized form of Quran, is certainly the greatest literary work in classical Arabic, and for all Muslim stands as the definitive word of God. So in Arabic, Allah, so spoken to the Prophet Muhammad by the angel Gabriel. Another one is Sumerian Code, about 3500 BC. So the Code of Urnammu is the oldest surviving law code. So this text was written on clay tablets in the Sumerian language, and it is recorded to have been produced towards the end of the third millennium BC. So apart from being the oldest surviving law code, the code of Ornamo is also important as it gives us a glimpse of the way justice was conceived in ancient Sumerian society. So next is the law of Moses about 1500 BC to 1900 BC. So the name was assigned to the whole collection of the written laws given through Moses to the house of Israel. So as a replacement of the higher law that they had failed to obey, so the law of Moses consisted of many ceremonies, rituals, and symbols to remind the people frequently of their duties and responsibilities. So it included the law of carnal commandments and the performance added to the basic laws of the gospel. The faith, repentance, baptism in water, and remission of sins were part of the law, as were also the Ten Commandments. So next is the common law. So because of the ancient legal codes had been lost during the Dark Ages or the Middle Ages, the concept of law and crime during this long 500 years period was in disarray and often guided by superstition and local custom. So it was only during the reign of Henry II that the standardized law and justice system known as the common law was developed. So under this common law, if a new rule was successfully applied in a number of different cases, it would become a precedent. So this precedent would be then be commonly applied in all similar cases, hence the term common law. So crimes like murders, burglary, arson, and rape are common law crimes whose elements are initially defined by judges. So they were referred to as malainse or inherently evil or bad. So this early English law became the standardized law on inherently evil and bad. And it became the standardized law of England. Eventually, it formed the basis of the criminal law of the United States, the common law. And we have also ancient legal codes in the Philippines. So we have the Code of Maragtas, which is the oldest law of Panay Island. Okay, and the Code of Kalanchau. So it is a mythical legal code believed to have been written by Dato Kalanchau of the island of Negros. So the Code of Kalanchau purportedly had existed during the pre-Spanish era. And it is regarded as the first set of criminal laws in the country, but some historians consider the code as a disputed document. Okay. So upon the coming of the Spaniard, the Spanish Código Penal was made applicable by virtue of Royal Decree of 1870, and it was later replaced by the old Penal Code of 1876 until the American colonization. Okay. So on December 8, 1930, the same Penal Code was amended through Act Number 3815, otherwise known as the Revised Penal Code. Dito na tayo nagkaroon ng Revised Penal Code. Okay. So the Philippine criminal law. So this is a brief study of the Philippine criminal law. So the sources of Philippine criminal law are the following: the Revised Penal Code or the Act Number 3815 and its amendments, the special laws passed by the Philippine Commission, Philippine Assembly, Philippine Legislature, National Assembly, the Congress of the Philippines, and the Batasang Pambansa, and the penal presidential decrees issued during the martial law. So these are the sources of Philippine criminal law. So next is the note that in the sources of Philippine criminal law, court decisions are not considered as sources of criminal law, since they merely explain the meaning and the meaning of and apply the law as enacted by the legislative branch of the government. So the characteristic of a Philippine criminal law, okay, these are the following. It is general in application, territorial in character, prospective, specific and definite, uniform in application, and there must be a penal sanction or punishment. So when you say general in application, all provision of our criminal law are equally applied to all persons who are living within the territories of the land. So regardless of their sex, their race, religion, and education, status, and other personal circumstances. But however, there are certain exemptions. Okay. So what are these exemption? Okay. The exemption of the exemptions are okay, as defined in the following. So head of the states or country, like the president, okay, the foreign diplomats and duly accredited ambassadors from other countries, foreign troops permitted to be in our country to participate in any war exercises, so they are exempted, or these are the exemptions under the in the general in applications. Also, there are cases where our criminal law does not apply even if the crime is committed by a person residing in the Philippines. They could be subject to the principles of public international and to treaty stipulation. So those are the exemptions in the general in applications. Heads of the state or countries, foreign diplomats, duly accredited ambassadors, foreign troops, okay, to be permitted to be in our country to participate in any war exercises like the Balikatan. Okay. Another one is territorial in character. So as a rule, penal laws in the of the Philippines are enforceable within its territory. And the whole archipelago, including its atmosphere, its interior water, and the maritime zone. So the national territory comprises the Philippine archipelago with all the islands and water embraced herewith and all other territories over which the Philippine has sovereignty or jurisdiction. So consisting of its terrestrial fluvial and the aerial domains, including its territorial sea, the seabed, the subsoil, the insular shelf, and other submarine areas. So the waters around the between and connecting the islands of the archipelago, regardless of their breadth and dimension, form part of the international waters of the Philippines. So to determine the territoriality of the seashore, the 3-mile limit measurement is used during low tide. Okay. So what are the exemptions in this rule, in this territoriality? Okay. So the exemptions are the following. Okay. The offense was committed while on Philippine archipelago, Philippine ship or airship considered as a flag carrier, being registered with the Bureau of Custom. So forging or counterfeiting any coin or currency note of the Philippines and or obligation and securities issued by the government committed outside the country. Importing or bringing to Philippines any counterfeited or forged coin, currency note or obligation or securities issued by the government and while being public officers or employees, should commit an offense in the exercise of their functions and should commit any of the crimes against the national security and the law of nation. This will be further discussed in your major subject, criminal law. So these are the exemptions to the rule of territoriality. Okay. And another characteristic of criminal law is it is prospective. So a penal law cannot make an punishable cannot make an act punishable in a manner in which it was not punishable when committed, since it can only be punished under the laws in force at the time of their commission. For example, wala pang batas ng rape, eh nang rape ka ngayon, eh kinabukasan meron na, hindi po pwedeng may apply sa iyo yung batas ng rape. kasi wala pang batas ng rate, no, ginawa mo. Okay. And next is, it is specific and definite. So, the criminal law gives a strict definition of the specific act committed. So, however, when doubt exists as to whether a definition contained in the revised penal code applies to the accused or not, the judge is to decide in favor of the accused. So, it should be specific. Okay. And it is uniform in application. When the law is general in application, the punishment given to the convicted person is in the same context that no exemption must be made as to criminal liability. So the defined crime together with the corresponding punishment must be uniformly given, although differently enforced based on the specific provision of the law. Okay? So, and there must be a penal sanction or punishment. So, when we say penal sanction, it is the most important part in the violation of laws since it acts as a deterrence in the further violation of laws. So, the Philippine government or the state uses sanction in terms of self-defense to protect the society from wrongdoings, okay, or wrong inflicted by a would-be criminal. So these are the characteristics of Philippine criminal law. Okay. So next is the revised penal code. Okay. The revised penal code took effect in January 1, 1932. So to this day, it remains in force. So ito pa rin yung ginagamit natin. It penalizes classes of acts that are generally criminal. So such as the murder or homicide, rape, robbery, and theft. And the elements that its crime comprises are also defined in the revised penal code. So the revised penal code has two parts, the book 1 and the book 2. So, book 1 of the revised penal code provides the general provision on the application of the law and the general principle of criminal law. So, it also defines and classifies felonies and indefinite circumstances which affect criminal liability. It also stipulates the classification, duration, and effects of criminal penalties. And likewise, it provides for the existence and extinction of criminal and civil liabilities in crimes. So, while in Book 2, it only defines the and classifies the specific crimes and their corresponding penalties. So, on the other hand, not all crimes in the Philippines are penalized under the revised penal code. So there are certain acts such as the illegal possession of firearms, the Republic Act 9165 or the Comprehensive Drugs Act of 2002. Okay? They are penalized under special legislation contained in Republic Acts. So with the abolition of death penalty in 2006, the highest possible penalty under the revised penal code at present is the reclusion na perpetua, which ranges from 20 years and one day to 40 years of imprisonment. Okay. So life imprisonment as a penalty is not provided for in the revised penal code, but although it is imposed by other special laws, such as the Comprehensive Dangerous Drugs Act. So, what are the parts of the revised penal code? So, the parts of the revised penal code are the following from Article 1 and 2, the date of effectiveness and application of the provision of the code, Article 3 to 20, felony circumstances affecting criminal liability and persons criminal liable of felonies, Article 21 to 113. Penalties as well as criminal and civil liabilities and Article 114 to 367, crimes and penalties. Okay. So, in criminal law, there are basic maxims. Okay. So, these are the following. We have the doctrine of pro rio, di nullum crimen na nulla puena sena lige actus nana facit trium nisimen cipria actus mi in vito factus non est mius actus and the lqs causa della causa est causa del mal causado. So in the doctrine of pro rio, whenever a penal law is to be construed or applied and the law admits the of two interpretations, one element, one lenient to the offender and one strict to the offender. So the interpretation is which is lenient or favorable to the offender will be adopted. Okay. While in the nullum crimen nulla poena sine lege is there is no crime when there is no law punishing the same. Okay. Walang krimen kung walang batas na nagpaparusa o nagbabawal. Okay. Actus non facit rium nisi mens sit rea. So the act cannot be criminal, okay, where the mind is not criminal. Okay. So the act itself does not constrain or constitute guilt unless done with a guilty intent. So actus non facit rium nisi mens sit rea is the maxim. Okay. The maxim is a cardinal doctrine of the criminal law. To be guilty of a crime under criminal law requires two elements. What are these two elements? So the actus reus or and the mens rea. When we say actus reus, a guilty act, okay? While mens rea is the guilty state of mind. Okay? So next is the actus me in vito factus non est mius, the act, an act done by me against my will is not my act. So this resulting crime is different from what is in the so when we say actus me in vito factus, then factus non est mius actus. Okay. When a person who acts under the compulsion of an irresistible force, like one who acts under the impulse of an uncontrollable fear, takot na takot, okay, of equal or greater injury, is exempt from criminal liability because he does not act with the freedom. Okay. So in this actus, non or actus me in vito factus non est mius reus. Okay. So for example is yung isang tao na takot na takot. Okay. As an example, uncontrollable fear, okay, of equal or greater injury. Okay. Nasaktan niya yung isang tao. Okay. He is exempted from criminal liability. Okay. Because of the irresistible force. Okay. Under the impulse of an uncontrollable fear. Okay. So next is the LKS causa de la causa o es causa del mal causado. He who is the cause of the cause is the evil cause. So what is meant by this? Okay. So example, in this maxim, LKS causa de la causa es causa del mal causado. Okay. An example of this is the death of a victim. Okay. Was due to her head falling on the pavement because of her struggling since she was being raped by accused. So, okay. So the causes may, which may produce a result different from what's from that which defender intended. Okay. So what are the causes produced? First is the mistake in the identity of the victim or the error in personing. The mistake in the blow, that is when the offender intending to do an injury to one person actually inflicts it on another, or the aberratio ictus. And the last one is the act exceeds the intent, that is the injurious result is greater. So these are the causes which may produce a result different from that which of the offender intended. So this will be discussed in your criminal law. Okay. So another example of this maxim, the LKS causa de la causa es causa del mal causado, is during a robbery in a passenger jeepney. So one of the culprits told the woman passengers to bring out their money and not to shout or else there will be shots. Okay. But one of the women jumped out of the jeepney. So when he jumped out of the jeepney, her head struck to a pavement and she died as a consequence. Okay. So this applies to any person who creates in another's mind an immediate sense of danger which causes the latter to do something. So resulting in the latter's injuries is liable for the resulting injuries. Okay. So what are the characteristics of, or what are the juries in criminal law? So there are two important juries in criminal law, the classical jury and positivist jury. So the characteristic of classical jury is the basis of criminal liability is human free will and the purpose of penalty is retribution. So according to the classical, man is essentially moral creature with an absolute free will to choose whether between good and evil. So thereby placing more stress upon the effect or result on the felonious act than upon the man and criminal himself. So it has endeavored to establish a mechanical and direct proportion between criminal crime and penalty, and there is a scant regard to the human element. So in the classical theory, they are focused on the crime, not to the offender. So the characteristic of the positivist theory in criminal law, so man is subdued occasionally by strange and the morbid phenomenon which conditions seem to do wrong in spite of or contrary to his by volition. And crime is essentially a social or natural phenomenon. As such, it cannot be treated and checked by the application of abstract principles of law and jurisprudence, nor the imposition of fixed and determined punishment, but rather through the enforcement of individual measures. In its case, after a thorough personal and individual investigation conducted by a competent body of psychiatrists and social scientists. Okay. So, how about the application of Philippine criminal law? So, the provisions of the revised penal code shall be enforced not only within the Philippine archipelago, including its atmosphere, its interior waters and maritime zone, but also outside of its jurisdiction. Okay. Against those who or the following, okay. Number one is should commit an offense while on a Philippine ship or airship. So for crimes committed on board foreign merchant vessel or airplane, the Philippine criminal law has no jurisdiction or application. So crimes or offenses committed on board in a foreign merchant vessel while on Philippine waters are triable before Philippine courts. So crimes or offenses not involving a breach of public or order, breach of public order committed on board a foreign merchant vessel in transit are not triable in the Philippine courts. So Philippine courts have no jurisdiction over offenses committed on board a foreign warship, even not within the Philippine territory, because warships are always regarded to be an extension of the territory of the country where they belong. Okay. So this will be further discussed in your criminal law subjects. Number two is, should forge or counterfeit any coin or currency note of the Philippine Islands or obligation and securities issued by the government of the Philippine Islands. Number three, application of the Philippine criminal law should be liable for acts connected with the introduction into these islands of the obligation and the securities mentioned in the preceding number. And while being public officer or employees should commit an offense in the exercise of their functions and should commit any of the crimes against national security and the law of nations defined in Title 1, Book 2 of the Revised Penal Code. So these are the application of Philippine criminal law. Next is the difference of felony offense, misdemeanor, and crime. So when we say felony, it is referred to as a crime under the revised penal code. Okay. These are violation a violation of special laws is not a felony. So next is offense. These are crimes punished under a special law. And also this is called as the statutory offense. Next is misdemeanor. These are minor infraction of law such as violation of an ordinance, okay, municipal ordinances. Those are misdemeanor. And crime is defined as an act committed or omitted in violation of public law, forbidding or commanding it. So whether the wrongdoing is punished under the revised penal code or under a special law, the generic word crime can be used. Okay. So what are the elements of felonies? So the elements of felonies are the following. Okay. So felonies, when we say felonies, these are acts and omissions punishable by law. Okay. So the elements is there must be an act or omission. Okay. The act or omission must be punishable by law, and the act must be committed by means of dolo or deceit or culpa or fault. So when we say act, it refers to any kind of body movement that produces change in the outside world, particularly referred to overt or external acts. So when we say overt act or external act, in some physical activity or deed indicating the intention to commit a particular crime. While omission is the inaction or failure to perform a positive duty which one is bound to do. So an example of omission is abandonment of person in danger. May nakasalubong kang tao na humihingi ng tulong at nilampasan mo at nakuha na ng CCTV at hindi mo tinulungan yung isang tao na duguan. So that is abandonment of persons in danger. Okay, that is omission. Okay. So what are the elements of felony committed by deceit or dolo? Okay, for an act or omission to be considered felony or a means of deceit or dolo, okay, first have freedom while doing an act or omitting an act. Okay. So the lack of freedom makes one merely a tool. Number two is have intelligence while doing an act or omitting an act. So what is meant by that? So the lack of intelligence makes one unable to determine the morality of his acts and the effect of his action. And the last one is have intent while doing the act or omitting an act. Okay, this is shown by overt acts. Okay. So what is the distinction between the intentional felony and the culpable felony? So in the intentional felonies, the act or omission of the offender is malicious. So the act is performed with a deliberate intent or with malice. When we say malice, it is the intent to do an injury to another or to the person, property, or right of another. While on the other hand, in culpable felonies, the act or omission of the offender is not malicious. If the injury caused by the offender to another is unintentional and it being simply the incident of another act performed without malice. Okay. So next is the criminal liability. Who shall have criminal liability? Okay, criminal liability shall be incurred in the following. Okay, by any person committing a felony or delito, although wrongful act that is different from what that which he intended, and by any person performing an act which would be an offense against person or property, were it not for the inherent impossibility of its accomplishment or an account of the employment of the inadequate or ineffectual means. Okay. So, what are the circumstances affecting the criminal liability? So, there are five kinds of circumstances that affect criminal liability under the revised penal code. These are the following: the justifying circumstance under Article 11, exempting circumstance Article 12, mitigating circumstance Article 13, aggravating circumstance Article 14, and alternative circumstances under Article 15. Okay. So when we say justifying circumstances, these are those where the act of a person is said to be in accordance with the law, so that such person is deemed not to have transgressed the law and is free from both civil and criminal liability, like the defense of oneself or relatives or strangers, state of necessity, or the fulfillment of duties, or the obedience of superior order. These are example of justifying circumstances. So another one is the exempting circumstances. So who are exempted from criminal liability? Okay, like the insane persons, imbecile, unless he acted during a lucid interval. Okay, the a person under 9 years of age. A person under over 9 years of age and under 15, unless they acted with discernment. Okay. So any person who, while performing a lawful act with due care, causes an injury by mere accident without fault or intention of causing it. Okay. So any person who acts under the compulsion of irresistible force. This may be under the exempting circumstances. Okay. So any person who acts under the impulse of an uncontrollable fear of an equal or greater injury. Okay. Ito, isa na ito yung nasa basic maxim natin. So yung basic maxim na actus me in vito, factus non est meus actus, an act done by me against my will is not my act. Okay. So next is the mitigating circumstance. These circumstances may lower the penalty by degrees. So the circumstances of the crime that lessen the responsibility of the offender. An example of this is a guilty plea or the cooperation with the police. Okay. Impulsive acts. So those are mitigating circumstances. Okay. circumstances of the crime that lessen the responsibility of the law of the offender. It lowers the degree of penalties. So while the aggravating circumstances, these are circumstances of the criminal act of the crime that increase the responsibility of the offender. Okay. It increases the penalty to the maximum, like premeditation, large profit from the offense. Okay. An example is under the influence of drugs, drunk, or driving of an unsafe vehicle. Okay. So those are aggravating circumstances. And the last one is the alternative circumstance. Okay. The alternative circumstance, those which must be taken into consideration as aggravating or mitigating. So it would be considered as aggravating or mitigating, depends upon the gravity of the crime committed. So like in parricide, okay, is as much reprehensible to the educated as to the illiterate. Okay, so in this alternative, for example, is in serious physical injuries against a child due to the excessive chastisement, okay, relationship is not aggravating. Okay, but in crimes against chastity, such as the acts of lasciviousness, the relationship is aggravating. Okay. So who are criminally liable? We have three, the principals, accomplices, and the accessories. So when we say principals, those who take part in the direct execution of the act. Okay. And the accomplices, those who are not principals but cooperate with the execution of the offense by a precious or simultaneous act. Okay. And the other one is accessories. When we say accessories, these are the persons who shall not, okay, without the direct participation, okay, who having knowledge of the commission of the crime and without having participated in the commission of the offense, either as principal or accomplices, okay, but take part subsequent to the commission, okay, by the following manner, such as profiting themselves or assisting the offender to profit by the effects of the crime, by concealing or destroying the body of the crime, okay, or the effects or instrument thereof in order to prevent its discovery, yung sinira mo yung crime scene, okay, bar harboring, concealing or assisting in the escape of the principal of the crime. Okay. So there are different types of principal, the principal by direct participation and principal by direct inducement or the mastermind. The principal by direct participation who materially execute the crime, they must appear at the crime scene and perform the acts necessary in the commission of the offense to be liable. Now, yung mastermind or principal by inducement, they are liable even did not appear in crime scene because it would not have been committed without inducement and because they induce other to commit the crime, so they do not have to appear or do the dirty works. Okay. What are the elements of principals? So force, intimidation, price, reward, or promise. This is the strongest induced mentor motive. Words or command. So the qualification, ascendancy, husband has ascendancy to the wife but not vice versa, and intent to commit a crime, if absence, it is only considered as accomplices. Okay. Accomplices, the are those who are not principals but cooperate in the execution of the offense by precious. Okay. They are also called the accessories before the act, instrument not only the not the author, and he knows the criminal design but does not inflict the mortal blow or the participation of minor character. While the accessories, the elements of accessories, they have knowledge of a commission of the crime, have not participated therein, take part subsequent to its commission, accessory after the fact, in any of the following, okay, by profiting, okay, or assisting the offender to profit from effects of, from the effects of crime, by concealing or destroying the body of crime or the corpus delicti or effect of the instrument thereof to prevent the discovery, and by harboring, concealing, and or assisting in the escape of the principal. Okay. So the distinction of accomplice and accessory. In the accomplice, participates before, during the commission of the offense, while accessory subsequent thereto provides or moral aid in an efficacious way, but on in a manner indispensable of the offense. And while in the accessory, acts in three ways specified in Article 19, profiting, assisting, concealing or destroying, and harboring, concealing or assisting the escape. That is accessory. Accomplice knows the criminal design of the principal. Accessory knows the commission of the offense. While accomplice is no exemption from criminal liability, but accessory, there are some accessories that are who are exempted under Article 20 and Article 332. Family within the fourth degree of consanguinity and relative in cases of theft, estafa, and malicious mischief. So this will be further discussed in your major subject criminal law. Okay. So for the before I end this topic, I would like to share with you the scope. Okay. Study like there's no tomorrow, because if you keep putting off your studies for tomorrow, you will probably too late. So thank you and God bless.